Hello, good day everyone. In this video, basically, we will see the ship shore safety checklist that is as per the revised ISGOT edition. That is, we have the sixth edition now. Earlier, also, I had made a video on this ship shore safety checklist, but that was from the fifth edition of ISGOT. Now we have the sixth edition, so this is a new checklist and we have to see this now. Now, this video will be useful for the second mates who are preparing for the mates exam and cadets who are preparing for the second mates exams. Also, it will be useful for the junior officers who are keeping cargo watches so that they are familiar with this ship shore safety checklist, because when you're doing these watches in the CCR, you should be aware and you should be familiar with this checklist. So how to go about filling this checklist and what are the points covered in this checklist, we're going to discuss about that and what is the meaning of the same. So it says ISGOT checks pre-arrival ship shore safety checklist. First is the date and the time. You are going to fill your date and the time, the port and the berth, then the name of the tanker, the name of the terminal and the cargo to be transferred, the products to be transferred, that is your cargo grade. Then comes the first section, that is part 1A, that is tanker checks pre-arrival. All right, so one by one we will see all these various sections in this ship shore safety checklist. First one is part 1A. We'll see it one by one, all the points. So point number one says a pre-arrival information is exchanged. Now this part 1A is to be completed only by the tanker. So you're going to say yes, status is, you've clicked it, yes, it is exchanged. And how it is going to be exchanged, that is with reference to this points which are written in the brackets here, that is with reference to 0.6.5 and 0.21.2. That is taken as reference points from the ISGOT. I will show you what 0.6.5 is and what 0.21.2 is. So 0.6.5 is this point. 6.5 is security plans. So this information is exchanged between the ship and the terminal. Okay. So whatever information is to be carried out, the information exchange is to be carried out with the shore. It has been done, whether what security levels are there on the ship side, on the shore side, and other security related information which needs to be checked with the terminal, it is done. The second is, it says point number 21.2. So we will go to 21.2 in ISGOT. So this chapter 21 is basically communications, and point number 21.2 is this information exchange from tanker to terminal. All right, so we have all this information. Tanker to terminal 21.2.3. It was saying 21.2. So we will see 21.2. 21.2 is pre-arrival exchange of information between the tanker and the terminal. That is security information, terminal to tanker information, and tanker to terminal information, like the name of the tanker, the call sign, IMO number, country of registration, length overall, beam, arrival draft, estimated time of arrival, deadweight, displacement, all this information, what is there in this relevant section of ISGOT, that has to be, that all the information has to be carried out in reference to this. So this is how it is to be done, that what is there in this bracket are the ISGOT section. For this particular point, I showed you the relevant sections of the ISGOT. So you are going to carry out this pre-arrival information exchange is carried out. So you're going to take yes. The next is international shore fire connection is available. All of you are aware what is international shore fire connection. So you're going to say yes. If there are any remarks, you're going to put the remark like, where is the location of this international shore fire connection? So you can write it here, that is available at the gangway. So you write available at gangway. So So anyways, I cannot increase the size here, but you are just going to, you are anyways going to fill it up with a pen. So this size should be accurate. So you know, okay, it is available, the gangway. Similarly, transfer hoses are of suitable construction. So these transfer hoses, if it belongs to the ship, then yes, it has to be of suitable construction. You are going to say yes here. And if it is not available to you, it is not available on the ship, then you're just going to write not applicable. Okay, now the thing is, mostly you don't have these transfer hoses on the ship. These transfer hoses are available on the shore side, on a crude oil tanker and on our product tanker. Sometimes you may find this jump, something called as the jumpers on chemical tankers. So that if you have those, then you should have a certificate of their suitability. And if you have everything in order, then you're going to say yes. Now, also refer to section 18.2 of ISGOT. Now, when you are filling it up for the first time, if you are a new chief officer, then definitely you need to open ISGOT before you actually go for carrying out cargo operations, before actually filling this ship shore safety checklist. So you should be aware of these relevant sections of this ISGOT. Now, it is already there in the bracket. So first couple of times when you're filling this checklist, you need to refer it. Later on, you will be very familiar with it. You don't need to open it again and again. Okay, so next point is a terminal information booklet reviewed. So that is given in section 15.2.2. Now I can show you this in the ISGOT. Okay, next point I'll show you. So you say yes, okay, terminal information booklet is received and reviewed. Next is pre-berthing information is exchanged. So as per section 21.3 and 22.3. So if I show you 21.3 again, so pre-berthing information exchanged. So we will see in this is got, what is this pre-berthing information 21.3. So this is 21.3, pre-berthing information, exchange of information. So for this, the pre-arrival exchange of information between the tank and the terminal should cover pre-berthing checks required by the ship shore safety checklist. Also see section 25.4 of ISGOT, including the following information. Okay, that is what is the information given here, that is tanker to terminal and or pilot. This information is there, that master pilot information exchange documentation, location of the chokes, bollards and strong points that can be used for towing this safe working load, number and location of areas on the tankers held that are strengthened or suitable for pushing, and details of identification marks. Summary of up-to-date critical information for the port call, details of the tanker's mooring system. So this you have to, this information exchange has to be carried out. All right. So we have completed this point also. Pre-berthing information is exchanged. Similarly, you have to refer to point 22.3 also. And once it is done, you're going to tick it. Yes. Okay. Now the next is pressure vacuum valves under high velocity vents are operational. Normally, this you check before arrival into the terminal, one day before on the same day. So you ticket say yes, and you can write it here that okay, tested on or tried out on whatever date. So let's say you can take the date today, that is today is 28th May. So you can write okay, tested on 28th May 2021. So you can write it there. Then next is fixed and portable oxygen analyzers are operational. So you're going to say yes, and you can write here also date tested on this date, tested on whatever date it is tested. So you can write that same thing here. All right. Now remember that this checklist, you fill it up with hand. Don't fill it, don't type it, because this checklist have to be filled up with hand. All right. Next is part 1B, that is tanker checks pre-arrival if using an inert gas system. So basically, if you're going to discharge the cargo on a crude oil on a product tanker, you're going to use this IG. So that time you have to fill it up. But if you're loading, you're not using the inert gas system. So that in the remarks, you can just put vessel loading if you are loading. Okay, vessel loading. So during loading, you are not going to use this, IG system. But if you're not loading, if you're discharging, then you are using this. So that time you have to fill this up, that inert gas system pressure and oxygen recorders are operational. So you're going to say yes, they are operational, and you're going to write the date here when it is tested. The next point is inert gas system and associated equipment are operational. So yes. Now the thing is, before you go for discharging in any port, 1 or 2 days before you carry out the pressure testing of your lines, on the same day, you are also going to try out all your inert gas system alarms and all the associated equipment. Everything is to be tested. So that same date you put here. The next is cargo tank atmospheres oxygen content is less than 8%. So you have to actually check it. You have to say yes. And whatever is the oxygen content, that it is less than 8%. Okay. Next is all of you are aware now that the oxygen content inside the tank has to be at all the times less than 8%. Sometimes on the terminals, they come and check and they carry out an inspection. Sometimes they don't. But whether they carry out an inspection or they don't carry out an inspection is not important. The thing is, it is for our own safety that the oxygen content should be less than 8% at all times. Now, cargo tank atmosphere are at a positive pressure. So that means the IG pressure inside the tanks has to be positive. It should not be in vacuum. So you can say, yes, it is. All right. Next is terminal checks pre-arrival. Basically, these are the checks which are to be, which will be carried out by the terminal. Now, this the terminal is going to fill up. You are not going to fill it up. All right. So these points are for the terminal. Now, these are the same points basically, but now it is done on the terminal side that the pre-arrival information exchange as per section 6.5 and 21.2. That's again the security and the other information is exchanged. So the terminal is going to say yes and whatever the remarks they want to put. International shore fire connection is available. Then again, it is for the terminal. Transfer equipment is of suitable construction by the terminal. Terminal information booklet transmitted to the tanker. So they have to send it to the tankers. Normally they send it by email. Sometimes, I mean, some ports, they don't send by the email. When the loading master comes in the CCR, at that time he gets it along with him. And the pre-berthing information is exchanged with the terminal, with the tanker. So this section part two is basically filled up by the terminal. So they will fill it up. You don't have to fill it up. Next is part three. That is now, again, the tanker ship has to complete. That is checks after the mooring. So once you moored the ship, these are the checks after the mooring. So the previous section, the section 1A and 1B is before the tanker arrives. And now the section part two is for the terminal and part three is for the checks which are to be carried out by the tanker ship after mooring. So the fendering is effective. That is again, the reference point from the ISGOT are there. You can keep a ISGOT for the first couple of times. You can refer to these points in the ISGOT so you are more familiar with it. So the relevant sections are there. You can read it. So fendering is effective. So you're going to say yes. So anything which you don't say yes, that means there is a problem. And then you have to take a corrective method. So if your fendering is not effective, you have to make sure that the fendering is effective. You can write the corrective, whatever corrections you have taken. Because if something is not in place, that means you cannot carry out the operation. So everything has to be basically yes. If it is not yes, then you have to take the corrective actions and make it yes. All right. The next is mooring arrangement is effective. So you want to say yes, whatever the mooring arrangement, you can put it in the remarks. Access to and from the tanker is safe. That is, it can be a ship gangway or a shore gangway, whatever is the means of access, it has to be safe. So you're going to say yes. Scuppers and save walls are plugged. Yes, you are going to do that. You're going to put the scuppers in place. You're going to put the save wall plugs in place and it has to be yes. Cargo system, sea connections and overboard discharges are secured. Yes. Spool pieces, if there are, they have to be removed. It has to be blanked and it has to be secured before your cargo operations are carried out. Very high frequency and ultra high frequency transceivers are set to low power mode. That is basically your GMDSS equipment, antennas, everything has to be grounded. They have to be switched over to low power like your AIS, VHF and everything, right? External openings and superstructure are controlled. There has to be only one gate or a door open to go out and come inside this accommodation superstructure. Everything else has to be closed. Your natural vents has to be closed. All right, mechanical vents need not be closed because these are anyways operated by fans, exhaust fans. Arrest everything, you have to keep it closed. So basically the whole idea of closing it that the cargo vapors do not come inside. Pump room ventilation is effective. So this has to be effective. And the pump room exhaust fans should be running. And wherever a person is going to enter into this space, 15 minutes before that, this pump room ventilation has to be started. A normal practice is when the tank and once you complete the mooring, the chief officer comes in the CCR after the mooring station, the first thing he does is he starts the pump room ventilation before starting the cargo operation. So, and it is kept running at all the time. So you're going to say yes. Medium frequency, high frequency radio antenna are isolated. Yes, again, all the antennas has to be at the low power. So you're going to say yes. accommodation spaces are at positive pressure all the time. Your accommodation, the atmosphere inside the accommodation has to be at a positive pressure. So the air which is there inside has to go out. The pressure has to be more than the outside so that nothing is sucked from outside, because outside the accommodation there may be or there will be cargo vapors which can come inside. So that is the reason why you have to keep your accommodation spaces at a positive pressure. So you're going to say yes. Then this you do it basically by putting your aircon into partial recirculation mode and pressurizing the inside of your accommodation. Fire control plans are readily accessible. So you're going to say yes. And you're going to also type the location here. Where is the, that is, you can keep at a fire plan at a gangway and then outside accommodation entrance, port or starboard, wherever it is, you have to write those locations here. So you're going to here write it here, gangway, outside accommodation entrance, port or starboard, whichever side. So you're going to put everything. So basically after every point, you have to put it in the remarks that what is the action taken for that relevant point. Next is terminal checks after the mooring. So again, part two was for terminal, part four is again for terminal, and these are the checks to be carried out by the terminal that the fendering is effective. Again, the point is same, but this time it is the tank terminal which is going to check. So they're going to say yes or no, whatever it is to be done by the terminal. They're going to put remarks. Tanker is moored according to the terminal mooring plan. So they, of course, it has to be yes. They're going to put the remarks. Anyways, we will discuss these points also, because these are also, these can also be asked during the exams, and also we have to refer to these points also, because ultimately what we are concerned here is the safety of the ship. Apart from the paperwork, why we are doing all these checks and checklists and everything, so that we don't miss out on anything, so that all our cargo operations are carried out smoothly. So access to and from the terminal is safe. Again, the ship has checked in part three, and now the terminal is going to check it again. It can be a ship gangway, or it can be a show gangway, or whatever is the means of access. Spill containment and sumps are secure. This is basically on the shore side. So even the shore is going to say yes, and whatever the actions it has to be taken in relation to this points number 28, 29, 30, 31. So that becomes a part four. Then again, part five is a tanker and terminal pre-transfer conference. Okay. Now till now it was prior arrival, then after berthing, and now it is pre-transfer conference. So this is basically going to be taking place between the cargo officer, who is normally the chief officer, and the loading master, who comes to your CCR, and this something what we call as the key meeting or the pre-transfer meeting, which takes place. This will be taking place, and this will be filled up combined by both the cargo officer on the ship and the loading master from the shore side, that the tanker is ready to move at an agreed notice period. So you're going to say yes, both the terminal and both the tanker and the terminal, you're going to put remarks, if any. Effective tanker and terminal communications are established. So both are going to say yes. And whatever is the communication, like VHF channel 67, or you're going to, whatever is the communication channel, you're going to basically put it here, the main channel and the backup channel, or backup can be a telephone number, whatever, you're going to put it here in the remarks. Then transfer equipment is in safe condition, isolated, drained, and depressurized. So whatever is your transfer equipment, it can be hoses or it can be chicks and whatever it is. So that has to be in safe condition. That has to be ticked yes and written in the remarks. Operation supervision and watchkeeping is adequate. So this is normally already pre-planned before you arrive at the terminal, like who is going to keep watch and who will be the in charge of the watch, who will be the duty officer, who will be the deck ratings. Same, the terminal will also be working on that before the tanker arrives. So both of them are going to say yes. Most of these points are basically, they were also in the previous checklist also. But I mean, now it is divided into sections, like one is pre-arrival, one is after berthing, and now it is during the key meeting or during the pre-transfer conference. So what the points which are contained in this pre-transfer conference is similar to the points what they were in the earlier checklist also. All right. So next, there are sufficient personnel to deal with an emergency. So of course, yes, it has to be yes. The whole idea is not all, everybody should be allowed from the ship to go at the shore at the same time. Mostly on most of the ships and most of the companies, what the practice followed is basically that 50% of the staff from all the departments have to stay back on the ship. Similarly, terminal will be having certain requirements, which are their own requirements. Anyways, but the thing is, there should be sufficient personnel on both the sides to deal with an emergency. Next, smoking restrictions and designated smoking areas are established. So yes, and here you are going to put wherever is the smoking room, like crew recreation room is your smoking room. So you're going to put it here, wherever is the location of your recreation room. So you put it here, officer recreation room. Next is naked light restrictions are established. Normally no naked lights are allowed. So you're going to put here no naked lights allowed outside accommodation. So you're going to put this here, no naked lights allowed outside accommodation, or you're going to put naked lights prohibited. Anyways, on a tanker, naked lights are prohibited at all the times. Whatever may be the, I mean, it can be a naked light, can be a matchstick or anything, but it is prohibited. It is only in the smoke room that you can use a safety match to light a cigarette. Otherwise, naked lights are prohibited anywhere outside accommodation. Inside also, accommodation also, it is allowed only in the smoking room to smoke a cigarette. Otherwise, no naked lights are allowed. Control of electrical and electronic devices is agreed. So you're going to say yes, that no electrical and electronic devices are allowed outside accommodation, only in the inside accommodation. They are allowed, outside not allowed. On the terminal side also, on the jetty also, both also not allowed. So whatever is the restriction, you're going to put it here in the remarks. Next is means of emergency escape from both tanker and terminal are established. So both are going to say yes, and it can be anything, like it can be the availability of a tugboat, or it can be using of the ship's lifeboat, or whatever it is, the arrangement has to be written here. Firefighting equipment is ready for use. So you're going to say yes. And you're going to also refer to these ISGOT sections before filling up this ISGOT checklist, ship shore safety checklist. Gentlemen, once you have filled it up one or two times, when you have referred to this ISGOT one or two times, you'll become very familiar with this. You will not have to refer it to again and again. But for the first couple of times, I would advise you to please refer to these points when you are actually filling this checklist, when you are actually becoming a cargo officer. Later on, you will be very experienced and competent to do it directly, because you will be knowing what is there in the sections. Next is oil spill cleanup material is available. So yes, and you can put the location here. Manifolds are properly connected. So you're going to say yes, both the sides. And if there are any remarks, sampling and gauging protocols are agreed. Whatever you have agreed upon, yes. That the thing is, you have to agree to certain protocols and procedures, because you see, this cargo may be containing very high amount of dangerous gases like H2S and everything. And maybe you have to use certain personal protective equipment like an SCBS set while taking sampling or while carrying out gauging. All right. Or if it is a non-inerted ship, then there are certain requirements. Whatever is there, you have to write it here. Procedures for cargo bunkers and ballast handling operations are agreed. So you're going to say yes, whatever the procedures are handled. Normally, most of the standard companies and ships, you will find that at one point of time, only one critical operation is carried out. Like if cargo operation is going on, loading or discharging, bunkering will not take place. Ballast will be in concurrent with the cargo handling. That ballasting and deballasting will be concurrent with the loading and discharging. Cargo transfer management controls are agreed. So yes. Cargo tank cleaning requirements, including crude oil washing, are agreed. So whatever you are requiring, your requirements, basically whether you will be doing tank cleaning or you will be doing crude oil washings, you have to agree on to those points. And to see these points, we are also going to see section 7B and 7C. That we will see when we reach this section 7 or part 7. All right. Again, in continuation with this, cargo tank gas freeing arrangements are agreed. So whatever the gas freeing arrangement, whether the terminal is allowing you or not allowing you, whatever the requirements are there, you're going to take a yes, and we're going to put here in the remarks what is the requirement. We will discuss about this point in when we are going through part 7. Cargo and bunker slope handling requirements, whatever is the requirement, you're going to agree on that also. We'll discuss more about it when we're discussing part 7C. Routine for regular checks on cargo transfer are agreed. So yes. When you will be following this, you have to put that in the remarks. Emergency signals and shutdown procedures are agreed. So whatever may be your emergency signal and shutdown procedure, you have to say yes and write it here, that stop into three times or whatever it is. Okay, so whatever it is, you have to write it here. What is your emergency signals or stop shutdown procedures? Whatever you are agreeing upon, you have to write it in the remarks. Safety data sheets are available. Yes, if you are going for loading, then the terminal has to provide to you well in advance. If you're going for discharging, you have to provide it to the terminal well in advance. It can be sent by the mail also. It can be brought by the loading master also before the cargo transfer actually starts taking place. So it has to be yes. You cannot start a cargo operation without having a MSDS or a safety data sheet available on board. Hazardous properties of the products is to be transferred to be discussed. All the information what you have related to this hazardous properties have to be discussed between the loading master and the cargo officer. Electrical insulation of the tanker terminal interface is effective. So this has to be made, this electrical insulation. This is normally done by a cable provided by the terminal. Tank venting system and closed operation procedures, I agreed. Anyways, yes. So venting is basically you are going to use masterizer or you're going to use IG, whatever. It depends you are loading or discharging. So you have to write it here. If you are loading, then you're basically going to use a masterizer to vent out the vapors. If you're discharging, you're going to use IG to basically put into the tanks. So you're going to write here whatever it is, whatever you're using. Sometimes some ports, they restrict you from using masterizer. They want you to use PV valves because they want you to release that vapors at a pressure. So you can use PV valves here, whatever is the requirement. Vapor return line operational parameters, I agreed. So whatever parameters, alarm parameters, or whatever other parameters are there, that the minimum pressure should be this much, the oxygen content should be this much, has to be agreed upon and it has to be returned here. Measures to avoid backfilling are agreed, so you're going to say yes. Status of unused cargo and bunker connections is satisfactory, yes. Basically, they have to be blanked, all the bolts have to be in place and they have to be tight. Portable very high frequency and ultra high frequency radios are intrinsically safe. So basically, they are talking about the radios, what you're using on the ship, what they will be using on the terminal side for carrying internal communication, and it has to be intrinsically safe. Now, on the tankers and on the tanker terminals, you cannot use any electronic or electrical equipment which is not electric, which is not intrinsically safe. It has to be intrinsically safe. It has to be certified, and a certificate should be there on whatever electrical or electronic equipment you have on board the ships. All right. Then procedure for receiving nitrogen from terminal to cargo tanks, I agreed. This may be required, maybe it says nitrogen, but you may be needing IG if your IG plant is not working, or if it is a chemical tanker, you may be needing nitrogen on a chemical tanker, so that the procedures have to be agreed upon and it has to be written into the remarks. Now, this is for chemical tankers now. Part 5A was for all the tankers. Part 5B is now basically for chemical tankers, additional for chemical tankers, okay? So part 5A says a tanker and terminal pre-transfer conference. Okay, this is tanker checks pre-arrival. Oh, we've reached section one. We have to go to part five actually. So part five is here. Part 5A, that's tanker or terminal pre-transfer conference. Okay, so this is a normal oil tanker. Now, if it is a chemical tanker, then you have these additional things. Part 5B, that is additional for chemical tankers, right? So for additional for chemical tankers, you have to fill it up here. If it is a chemical tanker, otherwise, if it is not a chemical tanker, you are just going to strike this page. So if it is a chemical tanker, let's assume it is a chemical tanker. So inhibition certificate received if required from the manufacturer. This has to be provided to you by the loading master. So you're going to say yes. Appropriate personal protective equipment identified and available depending upon the type of chemical you are carrying. You may need to have this additional chemical suits or protective equipment. So this has to be there before the cargo transfer actually takes place. So you have to say yes. Countermeasures against personal contact with cargo agreed. Say yes. It depends again which type of chemical are you carrying, and it may be a very dangerous cargo. Let's say if it is a acid like sulfuric acid, then you cannot just come in contact with this chemical, or if it is carrying a very toxic vapors, you cannot just inhale those vapors. So that depends what kind of chemical you are carrying. Chemical cargoes are very vast and extensive. You know, crude oil tankers and product tankers, the products are limited. Crude oil is basically crude oil. Products are also then for only a handful of products like gas oil, gasoline, naphtha, jet oil, and condensate. Some basically 8 or 9 cargoes like kerosene. I mean, 8 or 9 cargoes, not more than that. But if you go to chemicals, there are hundreds of chemicals and all the properties of all those chemicals are different. In fact, chemical tankers are different. They are type 1, type 2, type C chemical tankers. And so different cargoes are also divided into different kind of cargoes like cargo X, Y, Z, others. Now, so it depends what kind of cargo you are carrying. Accordingly, you have to fill it up. Cargo handling rate and relationship with valve closure times and automatic shutdown systems is agreed. This is again as per the ISGOT references to be made with this ISGOT, and you are going to say yes. Cargo system gauge operation and alarm set points are confirmed. So you're going to say yes when those alarms are activated. adequate portable vapor detection instruments are in use. So basically, when there's toxic fumes, vapors are there, so you have to say yes, whatever vapor detection tools or instruments you need to have, you are supposed to have this. Information of firefighting media and procedures is excellent. So what kind of a fire will take place on what kind of a chemical, and what should be the fire extinguishing medium, what you're going to use to extinguish the fire, that you have to agree upon. Transfer hoses confirmed suitable for the product being handled. So you're going to say yes. Basically, it is or the terminal which is going to have this transfer hoses. Sometimes you have on a chemical tanker also, you may have jumpers to interconnect your manifolds. And that time you may use these jumpers. So that also should be included here. Confirm cargo handling is only a permanent installed pipeline system. So it cannot be used by your flexible hoses. Procedures are in place to receive nitrogen from the terminal for inerting or purging. So if you're not having a nitrogen plant on board a ship, and if you're needing nitrogen on a chemical tanker, so you have to agree upon the procedures. Similarly, part 5C is for gas tankers, additional for gas tankers. So if it is not a gas tanker, not a chemical tanker, you strike part 5B and you strike part 5C. All right. If it is a gas carrier, then you are going to strike part 5B and use part 5C. Mostly, I am not sailing on gas tankers, so I'm not very competent to tell you this part 5C. But if you are in a gas carrier, you have to fill this part 5C also. But it is similar the way you are going to fill 5B, same section is there. Since you have been sailing on gas carriers, you will be able to relate to this. So inhibition certificate received, just like a chemical tanker, so you're going to say yes. Water spray system is operational. This must be a system on gas carriers for carrying out something to whatever maybe the requirement, you will be aware of it. So you're going to say yes. Appropriate personal protective equipment is available. So you're going to say yes. Remote control valves are operational. So you're going to say yes. In fact, you have to say yes. If something is no, then you have to take corrective action. You cannot carry out your cargo operation. Cargo pumps and compressors are operational. So you're going to say yes. I am not discussing more about these tankers because I don't want to tell any wrong information, because I'm not a gas tanker hand. So I won't be able to tell much about gas tankers, but I can tell you about chemical tankers and oil and product tankers. And we will just go through these points. Maximum working pressure are agreed between tankers and terminal. This is same for all the type of tankers. Whatever we're going to do, your maximum pressure, you have to agree here. You're going to write it down here. Reliquification or boil off control equipment is operational. So you're going to say yes, you have this equipment on board your ships. Gas detection equipment is appropriately set for the cargo. So you're going to say yes for this also. Cargo system gauge operation and alarm set points are confirmed, just like in a chemical and a normal tanker. You say yes. Emergency shutdown systems are tested and operational. So yes, and you can write the date here when it was tested on whatever date. Cargo handling rate and relationship with valve closure times and automatic shutdown systems is agreed in reference with ISGOT section 16.8, 21.4, 21.5, 21.6. Refer to this ISGOT sections before you're filling it this for the first time. So you're going to say yes. Maximum minimum temperatures, pressures of the cargo to be transferred are agreed. So say yes and write here what is the maximum temperature, what is the minimum temperature which is expected. Cargo tank relief valve settings are confirmed. So you're going to say yes. All right. Part 6 is tanker and terminal agreements pre-transfer. Okay, so this is the agreement for all the ships. Now you have to fill it up. Okay, so what is the agreement between the tanker and the ship? Okay, that is the tanker maneuvering readiness. Notice period maximum for full readiness to maneuver. Normally, how much notice you need to make your tanker maneuver, but normally your engines are always, they has to be in such a condition that they can be started at a very short notice. You have to be ready at all times, but whatever may be your notice period, whatever you required, you have to write it here. Maybe 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 30 minutes, but it should be agreed by both the tankers and the terminal. So you, the tanker officer is going to sign here, the terminal officer is going to sign here. Okay, period of disablement, if it is there, any period of disablement, it has to be written here, if it is permitted by the terminal. Security protocols, this, then what is the security level, and 1, 2, or 3, I mean, 3 normally no operations are allowed, but whatever is the level 1 or 2, and whatever is the local requirements 1 or 2, basically it has to be same, both has to agree on the same security level as per the ISPS code. The one at a lower security level has to increase the security level and has to be at the same security level as the facility which is at a higher security level. So you're going to sign it here. Effective tanker terminal communication. What is your primary system? What is your backup system? So VHF channel 67. Backup may be a telephone or whatever it is. It may be a shore radio provided to you. You're going to write it here. Tanker initial, tanker terminal initials. Operational supervision and watchkeeping. So who is going to, basically this is your, who is going to supervise this operation, who is going to head the watches, so on the tankers and on the terminals. So basically it is the chief officer and the duty officers, tanker terminal. Dedicated smoking areas, naked light restriction. That is basically, these are the items which are already covered and you have to write it here now. Now, dedicated smoking areas and naked light restrictions on a tanker, and if there are only tankers, basically you have to write your designated smoking areas. Earlier also you have to mention here, that is the crew and officer smoking rooms, and naked light restrictions is basically naked lights prohibited both on the tanker and terminal, both have to sign here. Maximum wind, current and sea swell criteria or other environmental factors. So you're going to write your stop cargo at maybe at 35 knots and that is the, or 35 knots of wind and 3 meters of swell or whatever may be the requirement. Similarly disconnect at what? Maybe you want to disconnect at 40 knots of wind speed and 4 meters of wind wave height or maybe long swell or whatever it is as per the terminal requirements or as per the requirements of the master. Unberth, maybe the requirement can be at 45 knots, but normally what is done is most of the terminals, it is 25 and 30 and 35. This is basically, this is although not a standard, but this is basically accepted at all the terminals. It can be more or it can be less also depending upon the terminal to terminal and depending on the master to master. So tanker and the terminal. So this has to be agreed well in advance. Limits for cargo and cargo bunkers and ballast handling. So maximum transfer rate of the cargo can be anything, whatever is your maximum agreed rate, depending upon the type of a ship, whether it is a VLCC, it is a small product tanker, it's a Suezmax or it's a chemical tanker. Accordingly, you have to write maximum transfer rate, topping off rates, maximum manifold pressure, cargo temperatures, other limitation. Normally maximum manifold pressure you have to keep about 10 on oil tankers. Cargo temperature depends, I mean, whether it is a heated cargo, it's a normal cargo, but normally this cargo temperature about 65, 66 degrees Celsius, or it is basically taken from the manuals on board your ship, because the cargo temperature can damage your seats of your valves, or it can damage the coating of your tanks. So depending upon that, from tank coating manual, you have to take this cargo temperature, whatever is the maximum temperature you can agree. If there are any other limitations, you have to put it here, then the tanker and the terminal both are going to sign. Then pressure surge control, how you're going to do it. Minimum number of cargo tanks open. You have to write it here. Tank switching protocols, that the first tank will be opened, then the other valves will be closed, or you will request the shore to reduce the rate, or the ship is going to reduce the rate before the shore changes over to shore changeover tanks. Minimum of cargo number of tanks, number of cargo tanks which needs to be open, tank switching protocols, and full load rate, topping off rate, closing of automatic valves, how much it is, whatever is the time there. Then the tanker initial, the officer has to put initial, terminal officer has to put initials here. Cargo transfer management procedures, action for notice periods, and transfer stop protocols. How are you going to stop? What notice you're going to require? What your notice you're going to require for reduction or increment of rates? So you have to agree onto that and you have to sign it here. Then routine for regular checks on cargo transferred area are agreed. Routine transfer quantity checks every 1 hour, half an hour, whatever may be required as per the tanker and as per the terminal. Emergency signals, tanker, terminal, both has to be the same. Anyways, it can be different also, but that has to be agreed upon here, that emergency signal tanker will give three short blasts on the ship's whistle. Terminal may have some other kind of a horn and they will give three short blasts on the horn or whatever it is. Whatever is the emergency signal being agreed upon, it has to be written here, both has to sign. Tank venting system, how you're going to vent. If you're discharging, maybe IG. If you're loading, maybe masterizer, OP valves. Whatever is the venting arrangement, or maybe you have a vapor return line fixed, so that you're going to put it here and both are going to sign. So basically this is agreement between the terminal and the tanker. Closed operation. So yes, on tankers, you always have closed operation now. No open operations are not allowed. So vapor return line operation parameter, if a vapor return line, basically this is to be fitted during loading operations at certain terminals, they fit it. So what are the operation parameters, the quantity of oxygen, the pressure inside the tanks and maximum flow rate, what will be maintained, that has to be returned here. And both the tanker and the terminal are going to sign. Basically, these restrictions will be put into place by the terminal side. Nitrogen supply from terminal, procedure to receive, maximum pressure, flow rate. If you are going to receive nitrogen, then you have to agree on this, that how you're going to receive it, there may be a hose will connected with a pipe will connected or whatever, how you're going to receive it. Then what will be the maximum pressure which will be maintained and what will be the maximum flow rate which will be maintained. This has to be agreed upon beforehand and both are going to sign here. Next is for gas tankers only, cargo tank relief valve settings. So if you're on a gas tanker, you have to write here the cargo tank relief valve settings, whatever is there, and both has to agree. Exceptions and additions, if any, special issues that both the parties should be aware of, something which is not being covered in any of the sections of this shipshore safety checklist, there can be certain exceptions that has to be included here from both the sides, maybe from the tanker side or maybe from the terminal side, that has to be agreed here. And after the agreement, it has to be signed here. So it can be any exception which has not been covered into this checklist. Next is a part 7A, that is general tanker checks pre-transfer, that we said, okay, we are going to discuss in part 7A, 7B, 7C. So portable drip trays are correctly positioned and empty. If there are any portable drip trays which are there, then you have to say yes. This is basically tanker checks, put remarks, yes. Individual cargo tank inert gas supply valves are secured for the cargo plan. It depends upon what kind of, I mean, you are on a product tanker, if you're using loading three different crates of cargo, then you have to maybe keep some IG valves open and some IG valves closed so that the vapor cone don't get mixed up. So according to the plan, these valves have to be kept open or closed. That is, you have to do this before filling this checklist. Or if it is you are loading a homogeneous cargo, then basically you can keep all the IG valves open and locked in the open position, and the key has to be with the responsible officer and not anybody else. Then the next point is inert gas system delivering inert gas with oxygen content not more than 5%. So at the oxygen content, oxygen analyzer, the oxygen content should not be more than 5%. You have to agree upon it. Yes, say yes. And inside the tank, it has not to be more than 8%. Cargo tank high level alarms are operational, so you have to test it. You can write here the date of testing, tested on whatever date you have tested on. Let's assume it to be today. So you're going to put that here and okay, this is tested. Similarly, all cargo ballast and bunker tank openings are secured. You're going to say yes, because no openings to be open, whether it is ballast or whether it is bunker, or whether tank, because during this cargo operation, there are chances of cargo vapors entering into this other tanks, also chances of accidents happening. So this has to be said yes. If it is no, then you have to correct it and say yes. Then part 7B is tanker checks pre-transfer if crude oil washing is planned. So if you're planning crude oil washing basically on a crude oil tankers, then there again it is a requirement. We are not going to go too deep into it, that at every discharge port 25% of the total number of tanks has to be crude oil washed in such a manner that in 4 months all the cargo oil tanks have been crude oil washed at least once, and then the tanks which are designed as a heavy weather ballast tank has to be crude oil washed during every discharge port. These are the requirements of the MARPOL. Anyways, we are not going to discuss that. We'll discuss here only this checklist here, that the completed pre-arrival crude oil washing checklist as contained in the approved crude oil washing manual is copied to the terminal. All right, so you and refer to the, it's got section 12.5.2 and 21.2.3. So there is a pre-arrival crude oil washing checklist inside your crude oil manual that has to be filled up and it has to be sent to the terminal. So I'm going to say yes. Next is crude oil washing checklist for use before, during and after crude oil washing are in place, ready to complete as contained in the approved crude oil washing manual. So you have these three checklists, that is use that before, during and after crude oil washing. These three checklists should be ready and this has to be filled up before crude oil washing. All right. Sometimes some terminals require you to take permission from these terminals before you carry out the crude oil washing. So this written permission has to be taken from these terminals well in advance. And before you start this crude oil washing operation, you have to inform the terminal and take their permission. Once completed, you have to tell them that it is completed. They sometimes may also require to have a look at your crude oil washing plan. So that has to be discussed during this shipshore safety checklist meeting. Then part C is for tankers that will perform tank cleaning alongside and or gas freeing alongside. it depends. Now we will see in this checklist whether these operations are allowed or not, but sometimes a product and chemical tankers, or it may be required to carry out certain tank cleaning operations or gas filling operations. So it depends whether the terminal is going to allow you or not going to allow you. So permission for tank cleaning operation is confirmed as per this SGOT. So yes or no. If it's a no, then you cannot use it. Then it depends upon the terminal whether they allow you or whether they don't allow you. Permission for gas filling operations is confirmed. Say yes. And it has to be written here that the permission has been taken. Tank cleaning procedures are agreed from the terminal. So yes, it has to be agreed. If cargo tank entry is required, procedures for entry has been agreed with the terminal. So you have to say yes, and you have to actually discuss it with the terminal and take the permission. Slope reception facilities and requirements are confirmed. So you have to say yes, and whatever is the reception facilities, that maybe a barge will be coming or the terminal itself will be taking through the manifold through a pipe or something. All right, gentlemen, this was about the ship shore safety checklist, and there are other sections also here that there is a declaration that both the tanker and the terminal are going to sign this declaration. That declaration is, we the undersigned have checked the items and the applicable parts 1 to 7 as marked and signed below. All right, part A is basically for tanker pre-arrival checks. Part B is for tanker checks pre-arrival if using inert gas system. Terminal pre-arrival checks, so this is before by the terminal. Then part 3 is tanker checks after mooring, so yes. Terminal checks after mooring, so they will check yes. Tanker and terminal pre-transfer conference, so carried out by both, yes. Tank part 5B is tanker and terminal bulk liquid chemicals checks pre-transfer, so yes, say yes. Part 5C is tanker and terminal liquidified gas checks pre-transfer, so yes. Part 6 is tanker and terminal agreements pre-transfer, so yes. Now part 7 is general tanker for checks for pre-transfer, so yes. And part 7B is checks pre-transfer if crude oil washing is planned, so yes. Part 7C is checks prior to tank cleaning and gas filling, basically on chemical tankers, on or product tankers, so say yes. Then in accordance with the guidance in chapter 25 of SGOT, both the tanker and the terminal officers say that we have satisfied ourselves that the entries we have made are correct to the best of our knowledge, and that the tanker and terminal are in agreement to undertake the transfer operation. So this will be in agreement by the tanker and the terminal. We have also agreed to carry out the repetitive checks noted in parts 9 and 10 of the SGOT shipshore safety checklist. This we will see part 9 and 10 after this, which should be occur at an interval of not more than 4 hours as per the agreement. Can be 6 hours, but normally it has taken us 4 hours. For the tanker and not more than, maybe for the terminal it is different, but let's keep it same, 4 hours for the terminal. It is to our knowledge the status of any item changes, we will immediately inform the other party. So if anything changes in the above checks when it is carried out, the other party will inform the other party, relevant party, whether the tanker will inform the terminal and the terminal will inform the tanker. Now signatories for the tanker, name, basically the cargo officer, rank, and signature, date, time. Similarly, for the tanker side, name, position, signature, date, and time. So this is filled up. Now these are basically the checks during transfer ship shore safety checklist. That is the repetitive checks. Okay, earlier we just had a column here, but now the points are given here, which the tanker repetitive checks and the terminal. Earlier it used to be combined, one tanker or terminal. Now we have separate. So repetitive checks. Part 8 is for tanker repetitive checks during and after transfer. All right. So interval time, we had agreed 4 hours. So after every 4 hours, it will be checked. Okay, so that you got to write the time here. After every 4 hours, you're going to check it. So you're going to say yes after every time. Okay. So these repetitive checks are inert gas system pressure and oxygen recording operational. So every time you check it, it has to be say yes after every 4 hours. Inert gas system and all associated equipment are operational. Repetitive checks, say yes. Cargo tank atmosphere are at positive pressure, say yes. Mooring arrangement is effective, say yes. Access to and from the tanker is safe, say yes. Scuppers and save valves are plugged, say yes. External openings and superstructure are controlled, say yes. Pump room ventilation is effective, say yes. Tanker is ready to move at agreed notice period, say yes. Fendering is effective, say yes. Communications are effective, say yes. Supervision and watchkeeping is adequate, say yes. Sufficient personnel are available to deal with an emergency? Say yes. Smoking restrictions and designated smoking areas are complied with? Say yes. Naked light restrictions are complied with? Say yes. Control and electrical devices and equipment in hazardous zones is complied with? Say yes. Emergency response preparedness is satisfactory? Say yes. Electrical insulation of the tanker terminal interface is effective? Say yes. Tank venting system and closed operation procedures are agreed? Say yes. Individual cargo tank inert gas valve settings are agreed? Say yes. Inert gas delivery maintained at not more than 5%? Say yes. Cargo tank high level alarms are operational? Say yes. And then your duty officer is going to put his initials here, right? After every 4 hours, it is going to be checked again. Earlier, it was not like that. Earlier, the letter R was written in the previous checklist. Now, these points are actually given here. So every time you are going to use this checklist, you are going to refer to each and every point and then tick it after checking it. Next is terminal repetitive checks during and after transfer. Okay, so this is also basically 4 hours. Now this the terminal will be doing, so I will not be going through this, otherwise the length of the video will be more. This is basically done by the terminal. Let the terminal take a headache of it. When you go to the ship, when you open the checklist, you can read it, or you can read it from the video. You can have a look at it by pausing the video, but I'm not going to discuss each and every point because this has to be done by the terminal. This is not done by you or not done by the ship. All right. So for example, like mooring arrangement is effective, so they're going to say yes. Access to and from the terminal, they're going to say yes. And similarly, they're going to cross-check all these points every 4 hours. So these are the repetitive checks by the terminal and the repetitive checks by the tanker. All right, gentlemen, this was about the ship shore safety checklist. Thank you for watching this video. I hope it will be useful to you, basically for the cadets who are going for their exams and for second mates who are going to keep their watches in the tanker ships. It has been seen that most of the time our officers do not go through this checklist. Now, be a good tanker man. Every time you go inside the CCR, open this checklist, go through what all the points are there, read through these points. And when this conference is going on between the terminal and the tanker officer, also be a part of this conference, a silent participator. And in this conference, read and understand and see what is going on there. It will be basically help you when you become a cargo officer, you become a chief officer. All right, gentlemen, thank you for watching this video. If you have any doubts or any questions relating to the ship shore safety checklist, you can always put that in the comments. I will try to reply to the comments and try to clarify your doubts. Thank you for watching this video, and I hope it has been useful to you. And please subscribe this channel, Master Mariner Amit Sangwan, and also share this video with your friends as much as possible. Gentlemen, thank you. Thanks a lot. And thanks for supporting me. Thanks for watching this video.